Too. She said, Mama, if you were down to your last dime and someone gave you $100 for groceries, you'd go and spend it on flour.
Right.
That's how much I like them.
They're used so much in literature to reflect times and emotions and love letters or anger or any of those stances. It just is an intriguing topic for me, so.
Flowers are the prelude to the sexual act with plants.
Somehow over the years, flowers were incorporated into that. And I'm not sure how that all got started, but we're glad because it keeps us in business.
Thank you.
name is Jonathan Ertel. I am the greenhouse manager and sometimes lecturer. My official title here is greenhouse manager. Take care of a teaching collection and also work with the any kind of research plants that are being studied. I work with keeping them alive as well.
My name is Michael Bryan. I'm a co-owner of the White Orchid.
And I'm Theo Vera, and I am a designer here. Michael would like to say that he is also a wonderful designer.
I pay her say that.
So. Yeah.
I'm Patricia Vornik. I work as a designer. I always have been a designer, mostly in the graphic field, anywhere from brochures and annual reports, but mostly exhibit design and doing panels for museums and other businesses.
Well, we service all your needs as a full-service florist. Babies, weddings, funerals, parties, bar mitzvahs, but there isn't anything that we don't do that needs to have flowers done for that we don't do for.
Working with flowers is just part and parcel of working with plants, in that the flowers come when the plant is mature, and then if they get pollinated or fertilized, we get fruit after that.
My grandmother had a very beautiful garden. She was very Victorian, and she had to have her lavender bushes, and they had to be arrayed in such a way when you walked up the path, you'd have a waft of lavender. If lavenders weren't blooming, they were dried in sachets and hung from the curtain rods, so you could smell lavender in every room.
I just took up flowers in the yard and working. It was kind of therapy for me. Everybody has their outlets and things that they enjoy doing. And I would dig out in the yard and plant. And it's just the beauty of seeing something planted and it grow and nurture. And so when the opportunity to have a flower shop, it gave me a different avenue of working with flowers on a daily basis.
I started working with plants when I had a year off between high school and college and was living by myself. Wanted some other living things in the apartment with me, but not the responsibility of something with four legs and running around and that I had to feed and that. So I started growing plants then, and by the time I was a sophomore in college, I had over 200 plants in my dorm room.
I went through the Master Gardening program that Metro offers, and it's a wonderful program. I am obviously still a very novice when it comes to the true art of being a gardener, but I wanted to learn more about what made a flower or a plant grow that I wasn't getting just from observing from nature. I think it will help me see a different light in what I represent in the flowers.
It's just right. The sun. It's just bright enough. With a light on the upper tops. But the grasses in the back makes them seem as if they float in the air. And the ivy seems to run up the walls of the shed. Moss on all the rocks, and the height of the hollyhocks at this time of year. Well, if they haven't been eaten by the deer. And it's all such a ball, till it's not, then it's dead, and it rots. Then you can't wait to do it again. There's a joy in the garden, one that stems from the colors and floral perfumes. How I love the delphinium, grew it from seed. The umbrella, the kids light on the patio, medium bright, just enough to be able to read. The unbuttoned stalks of the alliums are premium, all of it quite the reward for the tedium. I endured to make everything bloom. My joy in the garden has a cost I can hardly describe. It's my love which I hate, I'm a slave, it seems, made to this world I create. Cut the grass, fix the gate, and be sure there are bees so the plants procreate. There are too many joys.
art was my major and painting was my actual course of study. And painting, I was doing independent study in painting, and I had not discovered flowers at that point. I was more interested in pencil rendering and logs and trees and fields and faces. The flower captured me because not just that its petals had a uniqueness by its shape or whether it let light through its petal or whether it was really opaque, but because it would move. It responded to a voice, it responded to a breeze, it responded to a mood, it responded to light. And every one of those facets changed that flower's character. So it was sort of like, it was very interesting to paint a flower because one minute it would be one character, but it could change within a few minutes to another personality. So I found flowers were exotic and exciting and fun and playful, and maybe they'll only last an hour or two, or they might last for days or weeks, but there's a beauty there that I want to capture on canvas. And it may not be botanically correct, it may not be what someone else sees in the flower, but to me a flower has a personality of its own, and that's what's special about flowers from painting them. And I probably have different goals than some artists, because I know I have a friend who's an artist that, but she's showing in galleries and does the receptions and things. And I have a hard time putting a price tag on those paintings because they're from the heart. So probably I'm not a artist that wants to go out and sell them necessarily. They're just, it's like a gift that I want to spread.
A glimpse of color, how peculiar to discover the same, I suppose, once you know how all this goes, how this insight could arise from a rose.
Flowers are crucial to a whole lot of the food that we eat, because anything that has seeds in it, there was a flower before that happened, because those are fruits. Whether we call them fruits or call them vegetables, the vast majority of, anything that has seeds in it, there were flowers there before there were seeds and fruit. Flowers themselves, I don't think we eat so much. We eat flower buds with broccoli and cauliflower.
Life is a simple one. You do your job till your job gets done. There ain't much daylight left for a wondering wife. While other folks is growing corn, another crop's the one I've sworn to harvest till the very day I die. Life of growing broccoli, that'll do just fine for me. Farmer's life ain't always fun, spending hours under the beetroot sun. Broccoli plants don't give you too much shade. Your back gets tired, your skin gets burned, but it's so worth it when you job ain't good enough. It ain't too lucrative, I know it, but someone's got to grow it, and Lord knows there are times when it gets tough. But Tuffy's fine for me, so I'll keep growing broccoli.
color red has significant meaning.
Actually, the roses do too. Like if you send a red, one single red rose, it means true love. A yellow rose is friendship. I don't know what the others
are. And usually with white roses, it's more in the remembrance, that sort of thing. So each flower kind of has a meaning, and the color somewhere down the line was associated with that. And then the help with red in Valentine's, it's become so commercial that people automatically associate that with love.
Almost anything can play a trigger role in bringing back a memory, utilizing any of the senses. Flowers give us at least two possibilities there. You can smell a fragrance from a flower either at night, if a flower is in bloom and the perfume of the jasmine or something of that sort wafts over, and all of a sudden you're back somewhere else where you smell that smell.
Well, when it comes to weddings and that sort of thing, it's the girl's dream, her fantasy wedding. It's her special time, so flowers kind of add to that. It's your time to have those, and the fragrance and just the way they complete the room and the ceremony and that sort of thing.
And just the appearance of certain flowers. I know, for example, that the first time I gave flowers to girlfriend was on her birthday, where they were gladiolas, and almost any time I see gladiolas, that's part of what comes to mind.
Just those happy day flowers, or just because I love your flowers. I mean, we send them to people to say, hey, I care about you, enjoy this, and have a wonderful day.
That's always something I think of when I see gladiolas from one year to the next, even though relationship is long over and more than 40 years in the past now. Still comes to mind. So I think they're visually and from an oral scented point of view, they can be great memory triggers, memory enhancers, very memorable.
Well, we got all the rest done with no time to spare, so we need to pick fast so there's time to prepare all the... Howard?
Hmm? Oh, yes, that sounds fair.
Oh, look, there's a sail and hydrangeas today. Won't those look perfect inside my bouquet to you? Howard?
Hmm? Oh, yay.
The pink are my favorite, I have to confess, but they need to be white so they go with my dress and the Howard!
Yes.
One minute.
it had to be roses. What on earth would a guy who's as simple as I even think he should buy if not roses? Yes, I'm sure it was those. Then again, I suppose maybe not, but who knows? If I'm wrong, then my folly exposes the fact that my memory's not great. I can't even keep straight the details regarding our very first date, at which I was late. I was late. It was raining that day. I was running along to the restaurant when I realized halfway I forgot the bouquet. So I stopped in a corner store, panicked and wet, and the guy right in front of me had a baguette and a big bunch of roses and some stupid pet, and the smell of the roses I'll never forget. And he went to the counter to pay, and I heard the clerk say, "That's the last bunch today." So it couldn't be roses. Well, it might have been orchids. They're exotic and chic, and the petals are sleek, and compared to the others, they look so unique. Did I buy her an orchid? Let's hope that I sure did. I remember how it was so dark out that night, and the flowers I bought were so vibrantly white. They were beautiful, shimmery, fragrant, and bright. Wait, fragrant. But those ones are fragrant, and these ones don't smell, and I'm pretty sure orchids are pricey as hell. Well, the tag, you should say, well, it sure wasn't orchids, because I was a poor kid.
Howard?
1 minute! Well, it could be carnations. They're just the right color, they smell pretty nice, and unlike the orchids, they're reasonably priced. A good combination. So it could be carnations.
Howard!
Yes, I'm coming! Shade is the same and the color is right, so it had to be these. So something's not right. Carnation smells sweet, and he smelled like the ocean. He was delicate, baby, like suntanning lotion. Not only that, something else was wrong. These feel too light, and the stems are too long. Something about him is different. Sure, of course, right now I remember before. This word could run out of the store. So Mother planted it out of the floor. So why did you wash these waxy, she leaked the flowers and smelled it was like the leaf.
Gardenia in your hair.
Could have sworn it was roses.
Are you kidding me? I said, come along with us. The wedding is off.
The top part of the plant where you've got lots and lots of small flowers developing. So you've got this fairly long structure of small leaf-like structures that are the bracts that are surrounding all these flower buds. And that's where there's this concentration of oil as these are being, I would say that's probably a protective feature for the developing buds, as well as if they've been pollinated, the developing fruits.
You know, it's kind of social aspect to it. It's a personal reason. It's like great stress reliever. Smells good. It's a nice blister. So, I guess that's kind of my main relationship with my favorite aspects of it. Like I say, it's good, like, you have all the experience to sit around and talk with people, and things seem more psychoactive, so conversations get deeper and more outlandish and fun to get to.
Chemicals that are in the plant that may end up being something that we can make use of and enjoy are probably there initially to protect the plants. And then we turn around and make use of that substance or chemical compounds to find either medicines or recreational pharmacological
diseases. It's not really for everybody because more people have more self-control than others. But I think for the most part, it's got a lot of medical uses, like 23 states now it's used for medical reasons. I think people are starting to catch on. It's not as not quite what they thought it was in its first being, legal wise. We just tied.
Friday afternoon, he gets out and work is done. But with Monday back so soon, better cut straight to the fun. Now the skies are blue, nothing else I need, nothing else to do but smoke some.
One example of an intoxicant or a a useful flower would be the opium poppy. And that has certainly, because of its, predominantly because of the latex that's found in the developing fruit, that's what really is the key for the value of that plant or that flower. It's a Mediterranean plant, a subtropical to tropical, and as a result of it being useful and of interest to a wide range of the population, then it's grown over a fairly large part of the planet. Anywhere that it can be grown, it is going to be grown to some extent because it's it's another cash crop.
There's less harm being done for smoking cannabis than other substances. Opiates are more euphoric, more psychoactive. Yeah, they have more tendency to abuse than cannabis. Mentally, there's more and less related to it, more overdoses. It's a bad issue. Yeah, to the general public, let's say they're more dangerous.
The plants and the flowers themselves have very little control over us. I think that it is our choice as to how we interact with the flowers, especially with the flowers that are used as drugs or that are used to produce drugs. Even if we are addicted to an extent where we really need the drug, that that has very little to do with what the plant or the flower is doing. The flower, I don't think, I don't see it as a manipulation or anything like that on the part of the plant or the flower. I think that it all starts out as our choice being more controlled by the drug in terms of need or that sort of thing. That's still us. And the flower, the plant has no concern or care or control over that. It's just growing.
Medication, oil, food, decoration, and of course for recreation. It has quite a reputation for intense intoxication. Why the poppy's cultivation predates written history is not much of a mystery. So many drugs are derived from a single plant. Medically, we utilize these opiates to tranquilize. Without these drugs, we idolize, we suffer, and we agonize, remembering what's otherwise forgotten with a dose of OxyContin. Perhaps the most addictive and dangerous drugs known to man, No existent drug today can better keep the world at bay. Its blissful reverie can stay for almost an entire day. Sure, liquor takes the pain away, but it has nothing more to say. Cocaine isn't worth the pay, and marijuana's child's play. Compare them. Nothing's in the league with somniferum. Upwards of 50,000 dead or wounded in the opium wars. Until you dare to go explore how it is that we adore a flower that can cause a war, you'll never really know for sure if it's possible to ignore the unrelenting need for war that makes the rest of life a bore. Until you've knocked on opium's door, you'll never really know if it's possible to let it go. So many minds, so many brilliant minds were influenced by opium. What evils could be blamed upon the stuff that gave us Kubla Khan? When inhibition is withdrawn, reality is dead and gone, and there's no will to carry on. That's when inspiration dawns. To let the smoke ensnare his nose, to enter such distressed repose, abandoning all cares and woes, was good enough for Berlioz. Consider what it's given us. With all the fuss. 36 million. 36 million abusers of opiates in the world today. Is its grip too hard to shake? Is its comfort real or fake? The suffering left within its wake may well be worse than any ache. To take the drug or not to take, what difference does it really make if the life that is at stake has nothing good to measure? Then why not reach for pleasure? So we try our best in vain to rid ourselves of all this pain. We try so hard, we go insane, flooding our collapsing veins with serum from Papa Fair. Somniferum!
Also at funerals and other major events. Again, I think in terms of just their inherent beauty and possibly also the whole idea of bringing more of God's creation into view during those particular times.
And so then when it comes to funerals, the funeral business, it's that last time for folks to send something to their loved one who's passed. It's your last thing that you can do for them, and the knowing that the loved one has gone on. And traditionally, there were certain flowers that were used, were accustomed to always being at funerals, but now people are sending things that kind of represent their personality and a little bit more creative and a little bit more unexpected.
What's kind of interesting about a pansy is they all have the same amount of petals, but each one has its own face. He's almost very inquisitive in his look.
There? Did you not belong? Did I never care?
Jasmine Lawrence. My name is Lillian Florence Pollock.
My family members mostly call me Rose or Rosie.
I mean, I don't choose your name, but I think that there are some perks to being named after a flower. Just from what people perceive of you, even before they meet you, I think that people associate those kind of names with being gentle or kind, attractive generally. And those assumptions are made prior to even meeting someone. I think I portray a certain kind of aura based on maybe the way I'm named. And yeah, I think before someone really gets to know me, they kind of think, well, oh, she's really polite, or, you know.
I have a lot of flowery printed things in my bedroom. I do.
I do purchase a lot of jasmine scented things. I know there's like a peace lily and a tiger lily, and I've never really thought about like how I identify with like one kind of lily, but it's interesting to think about like how maybe those can be tied into different facets of a personality.
I suppose it is interesting to walk outside and be able to see yourself replicated in a living thing.
People often do say like you have a really beautiful name, and that's one of the highest compliments I think someone can give me. I think people choose to name their kids after flowers because it's familiar, and you know, it's proven to work. People enjoy them, they're very pleasing, and they smell good.
We're not gonna name someone grass.
Now we're in a different time where people name their child like Apple and like Brooklyn and stuff like that.
Roses are complicated, and they're difficult to take care of, and they're beautiful, and they're finicky, and they're prickly, but rewarding.
I'm glad that I'm named after a flower because I think it is a true reflection of my personality.
I'm pretty happy with the name I got. It's probably a name that I would pass down.
I am very happy that my parents named me Jasmine.
Well, it's very neutral. It's not biblical. It's not really historical. It's timeless. That's Mother Nature is timeless, and a beautiful name is a beautiful name, and a beautiful flower is a beautiful flower.
How do you tell your daughter you love her in a way that she'll never forget? How do you make sure she knows that you're there when she's lost or alone or upset? You grow old and nothing stays the same. Nothing but your she gave you a title to fit you just right. Shut your eyes, little baby Rose. Let your mind wander wherever it goes. I'll plant you down firmly and tuck you tight. So hush, baby Rose, you can sleep through the night. Tigers. tries when it's sunny.
Pierced our solitudes, I found the fresh rhodora in the woods.
Spreading its leafless blooms in a damp nook to please the desert and the sluggish brook.
The purple petals fallen in the pool made the black water with their beauty gay.
Here might the red bird come, his plumes to cool, and court the flower that cheapens his array.
Rhodora, if the sages ask thee why, this charm is wasted on the earth and sky.
Tell them, dear, that if eyes were made for seeing,
then beauty is its own excuse for being.
Why thou wert there, O rival of the rose, I never thought to ask, I never knew.
But in my simple ignorance, suppose the selfsame power that brought me there brought you.
It's presented, there's this beautiful bird with its gorgeous plumes, and this flower is thought to be less, but it really isn't. It may be small and insignificant in the ground, but when you study it closer, it really rivals everything else. It rivals the other big flowers. It rivals the plumage of this red bird. But it's found in a little unknown places where people don't look. And it goes unnoticed, but it doesn't need to go unnoticed if you just look.
I'm not familiar with this particular flower, but it sounds to me like maybe it isn't as elegant or as eye-catching as the rose, but nevertheless, it has its own place, just like in society. We can't all be stars, but we all have our own little place, and we bloom while we plant it.
And what I took from it as he was going through the woods in an unexpected place, there was beauty there. And from that, the red bird, and it just, you could find beauty in anything if you look for it. And sometimes it's right there in front of you and you don't even notice it.
Beauty is its own excuse for being is just a wonderful way of saying these are really not questions that have sensible answers. These flowers are there scientifically to attract a pollinator, but they're also one of the many things that is that we celebrate as beautiful. And to ask why they're there, you might as well ask why we're there.
Thank you.